Today, I have the honor and privilege of introducing my fellow student, and I would like to call her a colleague, Molly Schlumbohm. She is an Olwine native, I guess would make more sense, but she graduated from Olwine High School in 2006 and immediately started here at UNI. She completed her undergraduate degree in December of 2009, but during her undergraduate time, she worked in the UNI Herbarium. She also then started at the Tallgrass Prairie Center in 2007 as an undergraduate student worker here. And her degree for her undergraduate was an earth science degree. Interpretive naturalist was her emphasis with a minor in natural history interpretation. So try saying that five times fast. And she is currently working on her master's of science in environmental science. And we've got our fingers crossed for a May 2012 graduation. So with no further ado, Molly Schlumbohm.
Hi, I'm Molly. Thank you, Anna, for that introduction. I guess I'll jump right into it. My research for my graduate career is looking at tallgrass prairie species and their effect on biomass production. So to give you a background to build up why this is really important, as of this time, about 7% of our energy comes from renewable resources. The other 93%, you can see, comes from mostly coal, natural gas, petroleum, etc. And of that 7% of renewable resources, 50% of that does come from biomass. Now, biomass is actually a very broad term that takes into account, say, corn stover, wood chips, soybean oil, a lot of different types of fuels. Today, I'll be talking about native prairie vegetation and producing biomass with that. Now, why this is important specifically in Iowa is that for the past couple of decades, we've actually been losing native areas because of the demand for corn for ethanol production. You can see here, since the 1980s, we've seen a pretty steady increase in corn production for ethanol. But then once you get to 2002, that really takes off. And if I had a newer graph to show you that continued on through 2011, you would actually see that very steep increase continuing. Now, we only have so much land in Iowa that we can devote to production. So as marginal areas such as CRP are coming available because they are expiring, farmers are actually opting not to re-enroll their land. Now, this is land that is marginal. It is prone to flooding. It could have very shallow, rocky soil. It could be on very steep slopes. This is land that is not prime for agricultural production. But with corn at over $7 per bushel, a lot of farmers are opting to put their land into production. And in addition to that, with the economy the way it is, there's actually been a cut in the funding for CRP, so there's a lot of pressure on marginal lands being put back into production. Now, if you plant these marginal lands into corn or soybeans, what we are seeing is a lot of soil erosion. As I said before, this is not prime agricultural land, so you are seeing a lot of gulls and rills and sheet erosion, and not just of soil. Soil is not just the only problem with erosion. You are also seeing everything that we put onto that land washes out, be that pesticides, herbicides, fertilizers. All of that washes away with the soil, and it makes its way into the Mississippi River, down into the Gulf of Mexico. So this isn't just a problem in Iowa, but it's a problem for everyone downstream of us as well. Now, part of the solution towards especially reducing the soil erosion is to plant perennial biomass. As you can see here, the perennial biomass has a very deep, very dense root system that really holds soil into place. That soil is not going to wash away easily as compared to the shallow root system of this annual plant. So that will greatly reduce soil erosion, which will affect water quality. And in addition, if you're planting perennial plants, you are not going in and disturbing that site, not just once, but twice a year in both planting and harvest, and then any spraying that you might do in between. A lot of researchers have looked at monocultures for biomass production for energy. Sheraton Valley in southern Iowa, their goal was to replace 5% of their coal with switchgrass biomass. Requires a lot of land. That requires 50,000 acres of land to offset that 5%, but they are meeting successes. They did a 3-hour test burn in 2006, and as you can see, they got over 19 million kilowatt hours of electricity off of that test burn, which was actually a new world record. Now, we've done a lot of studying with monocultures. Now we're starting to move into polycultures. Tillman and his associates in 2006 published a research paper looking at native species. They planted native species together. They were looking at species richness, which is how many species there are in a planting. What they basically found out was if you increase the species richness, you will also see an increase in biomass yield. Now this graph here is adapted from their 2001 paper, which was studying the same site. This is just earlier data. And you can see you increase the number of plant species and you see a very dramatic increase in above ground biomass production. Now that is excellent data. We are using it, other researchers are using it, but there were some parts of the study that we looked at that we wanted to change. For instance, Tillman's plots were very small. He had other researchers go out and hand weed each plot a few times throughout the season. He used a very high seeding rate. It was over 400 seeds per square foot, which is actually very high for a planting. So it's very good for research. We have a lot of good data off of it, but not necessarily practical for landowners. I don't know too many farmers that are going to go out and hand weed plantings that they planted on marginal land. They want to plant it, secure that soil, and let those plants grow. So we developed the Prairie Power Project. We wanted to, first of all, replicate Tillman's work, but on a field level scale, such as farmers might use, looking at the effect of species composition on biomass production, and in addition to that, the effect of soil properties on biomass productivity. So our hypothesis, like Tillman's, was greater species richness will result in greater above ground biomass production, and then also that soil characteristics will play a role in biomass production. So our site right here is southeast of Waterloo, along 218 in the Cedar River Natural Resource Area. This is actually located within the Cedar River floodplain. The site has been flooded several times in the past, and I'll get to that a little later. It actually impacted this study greatly for a while. So our site on the Cedar River Natural Resource Area is a total of 98 acres. We used 43.9 acres of that for our study. We divided that up into 7 fields with 48 plots total, and you can see that the plots varied in area a bit. We had 3 distinct alluvial soils on the site that we were looking at. We had our Flagler sandy loam, which I usually refer to as our dry soil, our Waukee and Saudi loam, which is our mesic soil, and our Spillville Coaland complex, which I refer to as our wet soil. Now, our research design, we looked at 4 different seeding treatments. We had our switchgrass control, which is a species that Tillman looked at and many other researchers have looked at for biomass production. We had our big 5, which is 5 warm season grasses that include switchgrass, our 16 species biomass mix, including the big 5 with additional grasses and forb species added, and then our 32 species prairie mix, which includes the 16 species biomass mix and 16 additional species, including grasses, forbs, and we actually did add sedges to this mix. So each treatment was replicated 4 times per soil type, which equals 48 plots. And if you got a copy of the handout, and I see there's, if you would like one, they're behind you. These are the four seeding treatments. You can see the switchgrass control right here, and you can see switchgrass is in each of the treatments. Our big five, and those five are in the biomass mix, and then the biomass mix, and those 16 are also in the prairie mix, and each additional added species. So this is our site. This map was made by Dr. Myers, who is also using that site for his research. You can see how the soil types are laid out and how the treatments are laid out within each plot.
And you can see the proximity to the Cedar River.
Yeah, the Cedar River is right here. So when I say it's in the floodplain, it's right next to the river. So
that map was made by Jim.
It was made by Jim? Okay, I'll change that. So if you are making a seed mix specifically for biomass production, there are a lot of considerations to take into account. We used our experience with the Iowa Ecotype Project, now called Natural Selections and headed by Greg Halseal, to choose our species for our mixes. We wanted species that would be able to tolerate varying soil and moisture conditions because we wanted this to be used throughout all of Iowa and other states as well. We looked at standability over winter because many researchers have said that they would prefer a late winter harvest. So we need those, when the snow melts, we need those plants to still be standing. We avoided colonizing species like Canada goldenrod. We didn't want a colony of Canada goldenrod pushing out other species. We wanted species that would flower late in the season so that we would reach peak biomass productivity near the end of the season. We wanted species to persist and actually increase in production over time, because this is actually a prairie planting, which the lifetime of this planting we look at in terms of decades, unlike from year to year, such as for corn and soybean production. We wanted a low input planting, so we did include legumes because they are nitrogen fixers, which would take the place of our chemical fertilizers. And of course, we wanted species that are very large and robust and would produce high amounts of biomass. Now, all of our species were source identified, yellow tag seed. They were PLS tested. We used the seed weights that were provided by Prairie Moon Seeds, that nursery, what they published that year. And the seeds were actually measured out for each plot. So we had 48 bags of seed, one for each plot, to ensure that they all got the correct amount of seeds for each species. You can see our vendors that we used. They're Iowa vendors with the exception of Shooting Star Native Seeds, which is actually right across the border in Minnesota. Now for our seeding rates, for our switchgrass control, we sowed that at 52 seeds per square foot. This was recommended by the NRCS in 2007. If you want to produce biomass specifically with switchgrass, you plant it at 52 seeds per square foot. And this is actually our most affordable seeding treatment at $64 per acre. For our big five, we kept the same seeding rate, 52 seeds per square foot. And we divided that up among the five species with our blue stems, big blue stem and little blue stem, being seeded at 14 seeds per square foot. Now, we did up the seeding rate for these two species as compared to the other three, because previous tests indicated that these are the two species of the five that would produce the most biomass. So we're planting this site for biomass. If these species produce more biomass, we're going to plant more of them. And our biomass mix, again, grasses were seeded at 52 seeds per square foot, and forbs made up the rest of the 77. So all of our forbs were seeded at the same rate with the exception of compass plant, which was seeded at a reduced rate, and this was simply because of cost of that species compared to the others. Our blue stems we kept, again, at the same rate and reduced the seeding rate for the other grass species to make room for the addition of the other grass species that you see here. And finally, our prairie mix, planted at the same rate as our biomass mix. All of, again, grasses, and since we included sedges, our graminoids were 52 seeds per square foot. Our forbs at 1.5 seeds per square foot. And that does not include the four species that you see here. Those were planted at a reduced rate. And again, that is because of cost of those specific species. And this was our most expensive treatment at just shy of $1,000 per acre. And again, to remind you, this is what the site looks like, how the treatments are basically how they're spread out throughout the site. So our site was initially planted in spring of 2008. We drilled it directly into corn stubble with our native seed drill. Everything looked fantastic. And then 3 days later, we had that. I'm sure many of you recall the floods of 2008. This is not actually our site. This is somewhere in northeast Iowa. We do not have pictures of our site because we could not get to our site. It was underwater. The roads leading to our site were underwater. So we had to come back after the floodwaters had receded. Again, just 3 days after we finished, started flooding. The plots were underwater for over 2 weeks, could not get to them. We did see some seedling survival in slightly elevated areas, but for the most part, most of the site was underwater. And you can see this is what the site looked like after the water went away. It pretty much scoured everything clean. The plots that were nearer to the river, a lot of that soil was swept away, and then the plots that were further away, soil was deposited on the site. Yeah, that right there is a plot marker, and you can see all the silt that came in and probably smothered a lot of the seed that was underneath it, if not swept it away. So we planned on starting from scratch in 2009. For the rest of 2008, the site was leased to a local farmer. He sprayed the entire site, wanted to make sure he killed all the weeds and then any surviving seedlings that we could start from scratch the next year. He planted soybeans and again made sure that they were sprayed, made sure there was nothing else growing. He harvested them very late in the season. Now, because of the late planting of the soybeans, they were very small statured, so when he did harvest them, there was very little crop residue left on the site. So in 2009, we again planted in spring using our native seed drill into stubble. Now we planted the switchgrass first and then followed that with the big five, the biomass mix, and the prairie mix. And we did this so that we did not see seed contamination among the treatments, so that we didn't see forbs in our grass mixes, for example. And in addition to that, between each plot, we did blow out the drill again so that we did not see seed contamination. And the treatments and plots were planted in the same spots that they were planted in 2008. So we didn't plant, say, a grass mix where we had originally planted a forb mix. We kept them the same footprint. So in 2009, we did establishment mowing. There were not many weeds on the site. We saw mare's tail, we had foxtail come up, but in no real abundance for either species. Now, this year in April, we did burn the site. We burned every plot. It was very complete. There was very little vegetation left standing. We did leave the non-plot areas for wildlife habitat. And I will say that burning likely had an effect on biomass yields this year, which I will discuss later. And this is our plots being burned. You can see there's very little vegetation left. And right here, what vegetation you see is in the mow lane. And then I think that's Dave Williams lighting up another plot in the background. And then me lighting a plot because I like that picture. So, in June of 2010, we wanted to see, okay, the site's a year old now. What species have come up? So we did vegetative sampling, just looking at presence and absence of each species. And here are the four treatments by presence of absence. I did rank them saying, okay, in the prairie mix, we saw Choitic trefoil the most. So again, presence and absence were noted. Western wheatgrass, we did not get in a quadrat, but it was on the site. We saw it once or twice, just not in a quadrat. It's not a common plant on the site. And then in addition to that, the prairie phlox had really started to die back, so we weren't really getting that in our quadrats. it is there in pretty moderate amounts. It just died back enough that we weren't capturing it in our quadrat. And then also many species were emerging. So maybe we didn't get those in our quadrats, but for the most part, we saw pretty much everything that we planted, with the exception of western wheatgrass in a quadrat. Now for both fall of 2010 and 2011, we did our above ground biomass sampling. We did 10 random locations in each plot using a 1/10 of a meter square quadrat. We stayed away from the edge, so we didn't have any edge effect, and we clipped it about 1 inch off the ground. Now for our samples, for our grass treatments, we divided those samples up into warm season grasses and volunteer species. Now volunteer species, include weed species, and then in addition to that, any natives that had washed in or migrated into the plot somehow from the surrounding woodland edge, and any species that we did plant in other treatments but should not have been in the plots that we found them in. Now our biomass and prairie mixes, we divided that up into our warm season grasses, cool season grasses, which included sedges because we could not get the little strands of sedges out of the biomass clippings, and then legumes, non-legume forbs, and volunteer species. Now all of our samples, we bagged and tagged them in the field, brought them back to the TPC, and they were dried completely before we weighed them to get the dry weight. Now here is clippings of each of the treatments using a 1/10 of a meter square quadrat, switchgrass control, big five, biomass mix, and prairie mix to give you an idea of the sizes. I will say that this picture was taken about a month after I finished sampling and the plants had started to drop their leaves, so there was a little bit of reduction in biomass, but that's just to give you just an eyeball it so you can see what it looks like. The stats that we ran, we calculated the means of species suites for 2010 and 2011. We looked at we calculated our G1 and G2. Any p-value that was below 0.05, we considered significant. We did two-way ANOVAs looking at seed treatment and soil type, and we also did Tukey's protected test for pairwise comparison, and that was to compare the means among soils, seed treatments, and then interactions, and any of the one or two-way interactions were analyzed. Now for 2010, you can see right here, we did get increasing biomass yields with increased species richness, which is what Tillman found. However, in the second growing season, those findings were not significant. This will come up again and again throughout my presentation. The site is establishing, things are changing. We didn't see that the grasses right there. Once you added forbs, they did decrease in production. So if you add forbs, you will lose some grass biomass. However, as I said, we saw increased production with each treatment. So you lose overall grass production, but you gain total production with that. And something else very important to notice if you are planting a site for biomass production and you want low input, the more species that we added, the fewer weeds that we saw. So you increase species richness, you decrease the weeds. You increase species richness, you're probably not going to have to spray for those weeds. It's low input. Here is a shot of our switchgrass control looking straight down into it. And these plants that you're seeing here are Siberian elms. And in the monoculture of switchgrass, right underneath, there was just a carpet of Siberian elm. So for 2010 biomass in regards to soil, our mesic soil did the best. It's a happy medium, not too wet, not too dry. Our dry and wet soils did produce similar amounts of biomass. I was surprised at that. I did expect the wet soil to produce a bit more than the dry soil than it did. But based on these results, I would say that soil does affect production, at least in early establishment. Now going between 2010 and 2011, the 2010 is the red, 2011 is green, you can see there's a dramatic increase in biomass yields between the 2 years. Now, as I said before, part of that is probably because we burn this spring. After you burn, you see a flush of vegetation. But part of that is also because the site is a whole year older. Those plants have had a whole nother year to mature, establish, get those roots down into the soil and energy up into the vegetation. Now, as I said, dramatic increase between the 2 years with the possible spring effect. We still didn't see significance between the treatments, but our p-value was 0.06. It is just on the cusp of being significant. I expect that next year, again, as the site continues to mature, we might see significance emerge among the treatments. But you can see here, the grass, I don't know, can you guys see that? I can go back if you want. Oops. In 2011, the grass treatments produced similar amounts of biomass, and the forb and grass treatments produce similar amounts of biomass. So I think it's the forbs that need to mature a bit more, and we'll see if there is a significant difference in following years. In regards to soil, any soil interactions that we saw in 2010 basically disappeared in 2011. Again, the site is establishing. These plants are mature. They are robust. I think they rely less on very fine differences in the soil and are just maturing, and we're able to grow big and strong regardless of soil. And now, in addition to biomass production, we looked at plant basal cover. We did this so that we could look at individual species instead of just the guilds. So we did that for both 2010 and 2011. I'm presenting today my 2011 findings because that's the more mature year that we're looking at. Very similar to biomass methods, we did 1/10 of a meter square quadrat, stayed away from the edge. We determined the stem area coverage about an inch off of the ground, and volunteer species, we did not look at the basal area for that. That was just recorded as present or absent. Now, McLaughlin and his associates in 1999 published a paper saying that after year three, a switchgrass stand is considered to be a mature stand. Well, I'm looking at year three in this data, so we are looking at a mature switchgrass stand. And we had a mean basal area of 23.8 centimeters squared per meter squared. Now, that is almost 3/4 of the area that is bare ground still. Now, that is a lot of space for other species, such as the Siberian elm that I showed you in the earlier picture. That is space that other species could occupy. So we're not necessarily maximizing productivity on a given space just by planting switchgrass. Now, our big five, these are ranked from greatest basal area to least basal area. And keep watching the big blue stem, the Indian grass, and the little blue stem as I go through the following treatments. Those will pop up in each of those treatments. I was surprised that switchgrass played less of a role in basal area if you add species to it. I expected that to persist in abundance throughout each of the treatments, but what we really saw was that if you add species to a mix, you will see a decrease in switchgrass production. So our biomass mix, again, you will see big blue stem, Indian grass, little blue stem. Those were our top three basal areas for grass species. And then, in addition, shoitake trefoil and yellow coneflower, those were our top two for basal area for forbs, which relates to biomass, roughly. If you have bigger basal area, you could have more biomass for that species. And finally, our prairie mix, big blue stem, little blue stem, Indian grass. Those were the top grasses that were producing basal area. And then, in addition to that, our oxeye sunflower and our shoitake trefoil. And I will also say that if you look at the treatments as a whole, you should also take into consideration stiff goldenrod and yellow coneflower. And then if you want another grass, side oats grama. For early establishment, which is what I was looking at year two and year three, these species produce the most basal area, which roughly equates to biomass production. So if you want to get a harvest off of your site in the early seasons, you should consider these species, depending on your site. Again, the site is still establishing. Our compass plant, last year we had maybe 6 individuals that bolted and produced flowers. There were a lot of just leaves, basil rosettes, at the ground level. They just didn't produce a stalk or flowers. As that species matures, maybe that will bump up for production. Our current dominant species could increase. Other species that are maturing, current dominant species could decrease as the site matures, and other species that aren't fully mature could increase over time. In regards to soil, pick your species for your site. Dave Williams was in charge of our seeding mix, and for the most part, these species did great. If you go out to the site, they are above my head. You have to fight your way through them because they are so large and lush. They really love the soil that they're on. They like living on that site. We got good biomass yields from it. Now, for the take-home message for the project at this time, as of season 3, we have not proven or disproven Tillman et al. From 2006 because the site is still establishing. The species are sorting themselves out. They are changing. I really do believe that if not next year, the year after, that differences among treatments will become significant because all of the species will have had a chance to mature. Species composition will probably change. As I said, the species that are dominant now may die back a bit. The species that we are not finding as much of as they mature, they may become more abundant. However, although I think that the species composition will change, I do not believe that species richness will decrease. There was a paper published by Bullock and Associates in 2006, and they were looking at, I believe 8-year-old plots that were diverse planting. And what they saw was that after 8 years, they did not lose any species. The species that they planted and that they found in year one, they found again 8 years later. And actually, although the species richness will not decrease, it could actually increase because of weeds and other natives coming in from the surrounding area. I just don't think we'll lose species. If you are developing a mix for biomass, I would definitely say to include forbs in that if you're looking for good production. They were a major contributor to biomass, and I expect biomass yields to increase for the next couple years before they ultimately plateau, and I do believe that will be because of the forbs that we added. Now, if I were to sit down with a farmer and they asked me, what would, of my 4 treatments, what would I recommend planting? I would advocate for the biomass mix. It is an affordable mix at $600 an acre. The equipment you can rent through your county, and as I said before, the lifespan is measured in terms of decades. Now, I had the opportunity to attend the Midwest Biomass Conference earlier this fall and listen to 2 speakers that actually raise miscanthus for biomass production. That's another very popular species that is raised for biomass. There's a lot of research been done on it. And those farmers said that the costs run about $700 to $900 just to plant it. You need special equipment that is not at this time available in the United States. They used equipment that they already had, and they had to make special changes to the equipment. You can't do it by yourself. You need at least one other person to help you. And the cost of supplies, which is the rhizomes of miscanthus, ranged up to $10,000 per acre to plant. So it's more expensive. You have to modify your equipment, and miscanthus actually has a lifespan of about a decade. So between the two, the biomass mix or miscanthus, if you are looking for an affordable way to produce biomass, I'd say that our biomass mix is the choice to make. Outside of that, you have a diverse planting. You are creating habitat. Dr. Myers and his students have looked at animals, birds, butterflies, other animals on the same site that I am studying, looking at habitat, and they're seeing habitat being created. And in addition to that, you have a diverse planting. It is more stable. For switchgrass, after year 7 or 8, a lot of people have seen a decrease in production of plots planted just to switchgrass. Well, if you have a diverse planting and switchgrass declines after year 7 or 8, you have other species that could take up the slack. You don't necessarily see a reduction in overall biomass production. And finally, we got good yields. We got about 5.5 tons per acre off of our biomass mix plots, which is very comparable to our prairie mix and at a reduced cost. So I'd say biomass mix at this time, which is year 3, would be a pretty good choice. Now, as for personally my next step in this project, I need to continue to sort through my data. I have about 130 pages of statistics that I need to pull actual information from and kind of reveal the overall story for the site for biomass production. Once I'm done with that, I will continue to put it into my thesis, write my thesis, graduate, hopefully get a job, be awesome. So, as for this research specifically, we will have another grad student come in and continue looking at biomass for years 4 and 5 and measure changes as the site does continue to establish and mature. This November, we had the opportunity to bale one of the biomass plots in Field A. They harvested 10 bales off of one plot that was roughly an acre in size, and they got about 3.5 tons off of it, which is, if you remember, about 2 tons less than what I predicted for the biomass yields for the biomass mix. However, they did harvest later in the season, so there was loss of leaves. You can see this is the leaf litter on the ground. And in addition to that, they were using an older flail mower to harvest, and there was a lot of vegetation that was left standing, but they weren't harvesting it to maximize their yield. They were harvesting it to get some biomass off that they could take it back to Idaho Falls and actually test cubing techniques on it. So that biomass has been sent to Idaho Falls. We'll see what kind of results they find. Also in late winter of 2012, probably in March, Cedar Falls Utilities will be conducting a stack test burn using biomass off of our site. They will take 100 tons of biomass, which we definitely have, and do an 8-hour test burn. And they will be looking at carbon, SOx, and NOx compounds that they get off of that burn and see what kind of emissions are coming off of our site if you burn it for energy. And we will see what they find out. So thank you to Daryl Smith, who is my advisor, Dave Williams, who helped develop this. I come to him with all my questions. Everyone that you see on this side are people that either are also studying the site and we are trading information, learning from each other, asking questions, or people that have, just information that has helped me greatly. And then staff and students at the Tallgrass Prairie Center. Every single one of these students on that list at some point or another has gone out into the field with me to collect biomass clippings or measure basal area, be there a heat advisory or a tornado warning or any other type of unpleasant sampling conditions. So without any of them, it just flat out would not have gotten done. So does anyone have any questions?
You didn't add picking up thick trefoil seeds.
Oh, I forgot the picture. Yeah, should I take trefoil? As it turns out, the seeds and the leaves stick to you like Velcro, and you have to spend about over an hour picking them off your clothes, and you find them in your apartment over a year later. So I should have concluded that picture. I forgot.
Can you go back to the kilowatt an hour record that they...
From Sheraton? Actually, this might be easier.
was a site that they had in Sheraton that they got that off? Or that
yeah, if you go to, and yeah, once I put up the page, you'll be able to see their website. I just got this off of their website. That's too far. Yeah, if you go to iowaswitchgrass.com, all of their information that they've gotten through their research is on that website. Yes?
I wasn't paying attention, so you may have had that in your data table and my mind just glossed over it. So if you did, I apologize. If you didn't, do you have a feel for how much biomass is the result of the volunteer species?
Not a lot. I can go to my tables, and I do have the volunteer species, their yields on there. And I'll go to 2011 just because that's the more mature year.
Sounds good.
Can you read that? I know my tables are really small.
And the lights aren't helping.
Oh, whoops. You know what?
At the bottom.
We'll just do.
There it is.
Well, that didn't help at all. Never mind.
Don't get safe.
Nope.
I think I see what I need to see.
Oh, okay. What did it do? Oh, okay. This is the longest presentation ever. Oh. There. Our volunteer species are at the bottom. So our total biomass production was around 4 to 5. And our volunteer species, you can see it's less than 0.3 tons.
And it looks like all of your little stuff, your legumes and your forbs and stuff, yeah, all overwhelm that.
Yeah. Weeds were just not a problem on this site, especially in 2011. I mean, our native vegetation that we planted was about yay tall, and our weeds were about that tall. And they were sickly looking. They were just being crowded out. They didn't get any sun. Weeds were not a problem. Weeds are in the volunteer species. Also included in volunteer species, I should say, are our native plants. So then if I'm looking at a treatment too, and I say volunteer species, that could mean a thistle, that could mean oxeye sunflower. But again, we weren't finding.
So based on this, it looks like probably most of your volunteer species were species from the prairie mix that were growing in the other plants.
I would say that it's probably species that we planted that washed in from other plots, and they just didn't wash in a whole lot. So volunteer species as a whole were not really abundant on the site.
Just going back, wouldn't you probably say that the greatest problem in the long run, if you don't burn periodically, is going to be the Siberian ale volunteers in the switchgrass?
If we had not burned this year, I would have expected the Siberian elm. I mean, last year, some of the Siberian elms were this tall. Now, I don't know how fast Siberian elm grows each year, but it could have become a problem that fire might not have been able to fix. Yes?
Did you, in your dominant species for your basal area data, did you see differences in those by soil type at all?
Let me check. By soil?
Or did you look at it by soil type?
Actually, no, I didn't look at it by soil type for this. That might be something I do later on, but for the sake of this presentation, I couldn't get that data ready in time.
Okay. Be interesting to look at.
We definitely have the data, so yep. I can look at that after this. So, yes?
There's another story here, maybe, beyond your project. You equalize the seeding rate of all the forbs, right? They're all like 3.5 seeds per bud. I mean, it seems like there's an opportunity there to look at how frequency of species based on an equalized seeding rate over those soil types. That might be interesting. He's at Hutter.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting publication.
And we have more data than I have done anything with for this presentation, especially. I am, again, sorting through all my data. Yes?
This might be another one of those kind of questions, but did you look at whether or not the increase in yield between 2010 and 2011, did it increase equally among all the treatments? Or
well, you can get kind of an idea if you look at, let's see which direction I need to go. At the, that's divided up by treatment. Now, in 2010, the Big Five outproduced the switchgrass control. That was not the case in 2011. The switchgrass did better than the Big Five. So it wasn't quite equally. But overall, I mean, here's my 2010 yields. Here's my 2011 yields.
Those p-values are within each year for the effect of the treatment?
Mm-hmm. Yes?
I'm not a prairie guy. Could you speculate how much trouble the next grad student's going to have if this area suffers another major flood? And I'm picturing flood in the middle of the summer rather than an early spring flood. In terms of how these, how your multicultural plots will respond to being submerged.
Might depend on how long they're submerged. I'm glad I'm not that student. So if that happens, I do feel bad for the next one.
I think if we get something like 2008, there's potential problems.
Yeah.
We had a plot not north of town where the rotary is planted and was inundated. It has recovered, but mm-hmm. it took a period of time to recover. So obviously that's going to be a potential. I hold my breath.
Yeah. In 2010, we did get some minor flooding in different plots, and it didn't really seem to affect the vegetation that much. But that was very minor flooding and only parts of the plots, so.
Short time.
Yeah. It's a flood prone area, so.
And it was also, if I remember, I believe it was all in the early spring rather than summer.
In 2000, said 2010.
We had flooding in July as well.
Yeah, into the summer.
Certain areas that were underwater for
yeah.
at least a week.
I'm gonna say field E seemed to have areas that were underwater.
Yeah, south end E was underwater for quite a while.
Mm-hmm. No, I wouldn't say so. The vegetation looks...
It's not as big a problem where the stuff's established as it was when we had just seeded it.
Yes.
On your harvest window, what did you use to determine that to be a good time to do it?
For when we did our sampling?
Yeah, but did you base it off of water, moisture? Or?
Well, the reason that we decided to sample in late summer, early fall was because that's what other researchers when they did their sampling, and in addition to that, we want to make sure, because this took a few weeks to actually do all of the sampling, we want to make sure that we did it before foul weather hit. So
have you seen at all any relation to the ability to pellet or brick, or I can't remember what you wanted to do with this stuff, but
they were going to cube it,
harvesting that at an optimal moisture to get better efficiencies out of pelleting or breaker.
I did see a few articles that say harvest after a killing frost.
Okay.
So give the vegetation a bit of time to dry out. I mean, when we did our sampling, we dried out all the samples anyway, so we'd get a good weight off of it. But I imagine it'd be a lot easier to work with if it's completely dry.
Okay.
And just to add something to that, we've got another thesis going right now where some of the people who are doing this feel that, like Molly said, like maybe a lake's winter burn is better because you also get some of the chemicals that are in the stems and stuff that are either breaking down or moving out. And so those chemicals can cause potential slagging in the furnace. So that's why some of the biomass people are thinking maybe you should harvest in late February or March. We're taking a look at some of that, but we're not going to resolve it all. But that's still a debatable thing because you're going to get your greatest biomass shortly after the killing frost,
mm-hmm.
but because you start losing leaves and everything else after that. But that may be counterbalanced by the chemicals that are going out as the dormancy increases.
That's why I almost wonder if maybe there'd be a place where you could, want to kill that plant before this frost to try to capture maybe more energies in the plant above the root system.
Yeah, possibly. Then the chemical thing comes in.
Yeah.
So,
right.
And then you have the other thing that Mark is looking at is the habitat situation mm-hmm. too. It's later in the dormancy season, the habitat loss isn't as great.
Right, but I guess I'm looking at it more from a production standpoint yeah. Making energy. What about harvest cycles? You thinking annually?
Years? Daryl take over that because they're actually looking at that right
we're
now.
We're starting to look at that. I don't think annual will work. But we're doing just starting a comparative study this coming year on whether every other year or every third year.
You mentioned that plateau, or you're, I think you said you're forecasting
yeah.
a plateau. I don't know, you haven't seen it yet.
Not yet.
Old enough, but
mm-hmm.
on that biomass mix, when did you say you forecasted that plateau?
I would say in the next few years at least. I'm not quite sure specifically which year, but I would say we've got another year or two of establishment going on, at least, before we start to see a plateau.